So this panel is on LARP the next 15 years. I assume that the inspiration here is the fact that Neil has been running for 15 years so far. And so, you know, we can push it forward. And I don't come into this with a lot of agenda. I think that it would be useful if the audience gets involved. This is probably going to be more interesting as a discussion. I certainly don't have a presentation here.
Yes, especially since you know, it's very speculative, because it's going to depend a lot on, you know, social changes and technology changes, and, you know, who knows what's going to be available in the next 10 or 15 years. But if it is available, I'm sure LARPs will use it.
It seems likely.
I mean, we could start by looking at what's happened in the past 15 years with some of that.
That's a likely a good spot.
Yeah, I mean, it's funny. The evolution comes in interesting fits and starts. Things have actually changed less in the past 15 years, for Intercon specifically. Things have changed less, I would say, in the past 15 years than they had in the 13 before that. I mean, you know, from Intercon 3, when I started Intercon A, things changed dramatically, in large part because we had the introduction of short-form games.
Okay.
I mean, you know, it's sort of the, you know, back in the old days, everything was weekenders. Nobody even thought that a four-hour game was possible, and then they came in and took over. What I'm finding really interesting is the fact that theater and Boffer are starting to really cross-pollinate for pretty much the first time ever. I mean, you know this topic better than I do, but yeah. that collision of the two styles panel was fascinating.
Yeah, the collision of techniques, to a certain degree, I think that's more of a social evolution as much as a technique evolution, because one of the things that is happening with the cross-pollination of the different cultures, with people from theater styles going out and saying, yes, Boffer has use for us, and vice versa, that there's the social change is creating some mechanics changes and some other. One of the things that I think might be happening is that there is sort of a need for our groups to grow, spread, and cross-pollinate. And it's just sort of a natural thing, instead of stagnating in the same social groups, same social circles.
And same techniques. I mean, you know, the thing is that, you know, for so long we had theater style / IL over on this end and Boffer over on this end, and they were very different, and everyone knew what each one meant, and they were different in every respect. And I think everyone's become much more sensitive in the past 5 years to just how artificial those distinctions are. And the fact that, you know, there are half a dozen different dimensions in which they have been separate, that there's no good reason for those to be separate.
And where they were actually doing some of the same things. There were some Boffer writers who were doing these things, and it was theater style stuff. It was pure theater style stuff. And I think there are some people who are writing short form games here at Intercon who are like, I want a full immersive, directly interactive, very Boffer style game. You know, quick combat resolution, you know, things like that. And now it's very interesting, instead of trying to recreate the wheel, we're talking to each other and saying, how do your wheels roll?
I think what stands out for me right now in some of that crossover is that for the first time in a long time, from my perspective, since, I don't know, the Mind's Eye days, we have a number of games out there using a consistent rule set and a cross-compatible system, which is something that, like I said, I haven't seen in a really, really long time, since about the Mind's Eye theater days, and I think is something that we're going to see more of, because it's working so well in that hybrid scenario setup.
Yeah, that's something that comes and goes, is that, you know, it's one of those things like centralized, decentralized. It's something that's going to come and go. A centralized system that a lot of games use is going to be popular for a while. that's going to be a thing that comes and it's going to work pretty well. And then people are going to say, well, there are limitations to this and I want my own system, and then it'll fall out of popularity and come, you know, I think that's going to come and go in waves. But it's definitely surging, that style right now, I think.
Yeah. I mean, another thing that I think is starting to grow now somewhat as a result of that cross-pollination is folks are getting a lot more serious about the theory of LARP.
Mm.
I mean, you know, Nelko is a good illustration of the fact that everyone is, because of the fact that everyone now knows that there are multiple ways to do things and many dimensions on which to do them, everybody is starting to think about that more carefully. And so one of the things I really expect to see over the next 15 years is probably many attempts to reify, you know, a grand unified theory of LARP, which I suspect will always fail, but will produce some very useful arguments.
Yes, and result in a lot of interesting experiments, some of which have been done again before, and will be probed again in different ways. People will take ideas that may have worked or failed before and expand on those and try to create new systems. And particularly in short form, one of the reasons why I think short form became very popular here in Intercon is because people who had an idea but didn't want to write up a whole weekend event could create a game. And while it's still a lot of work,
it's not nearly as much
work. Yes, or the same commitment.
Yeah.
Well, as I say, expanding on that,
looking
at the future, one thing that I've noticed over the last 15 years
is
that we used to have more larger games, fewer larger games at whatever, at Intercon, and now we have more smaller games.
Yeah, I've been...
Do you expect that to continue? Do you think it's going to reverse?
I think that at the moment we're approaching almost an extreme. I mean, you know, Intercon at this point, the number of bids we're getting for 10-player games is really impressive and a little scary. I mean, looking at it from a BidCon perspective, I keep looking at this going, oh my god, oh my god, oh my god, we don't have enough player slots.
Yeah.
Because everyone is bidding these little tiny games and it doesn't fit the rooms. And I mean, I think the only reason we're surviving is the fact that we've got all those suites. You know, and that has been a major change. My suspicion is that small games are here to stay. I have trouble seeing it getting much more extreme than it is at this point. we actually have a substantial number of six person game bids.
Yeah.
And I mean, I think it's hard to run. It's hard to get much smaller than six people and still have a really interesting game.
The trajectory I see there is that it used to be that people would take a year, 2 years, sometimes 3 years to write a large game.
Yep.
Then write a big game with 40 or 50 people. Now we have people who write a game every year.
Yeah.
And to accommodate that pace, they write smaller games for fewer people.
Yes.
Or they build a team of people that's writing this campaign theater or buffer style where this team is getting together and writing several smaller events that take place throughout the year. So again, they're accelerating the pace of their creativity by having to do multiple events per year instead of one game per year or one game every 3 years.
Yeah,
and that's another effect of cross-pollination with the Boffer campaign is that, for example, The Shadows of the Moon, which has a lot of, which has some theater-style writers in it, we're doing four full weekend events a year, and about 30 plots, and that's a lot. There's a lot of writing that goes into that, and I think each event, at least for, you know, two of us, could be a full game here at Intercon.
Yeah. Do you see that lessening, breaking down over the next 15 years, or just ramping up even more?
I think that there will be some people who are who want to write bigger, larger stories, who are going to move more into things like the campaign game, move into, if they want to have a really big story, something that's really, truly epic, instead of doing these small personal games, which are six people, or even like 20 or 30 people, they're going to look to campaign formats for fulfillment for that kind of thing, because you can tell a longer story, a more organic story that grows over time, and create a richer campaign environment and world to a certain degree.
Yeah, I mean it's a difference in taste. I mean, writing a campaign is not the same thing as writing
a weekend game. Yeah.
You know, they're very different styles. I mean, a campaign game, it requires a somewhat different headspace. It's a more collaborative experience with your players.
Yeah.
It says the man who hasn't actually written one, but one of these years, it's a,
and your other writers, you know, you've got a team of 10 or 12 writers,
right,
and you've got to work together.
Right. You know, it is, I mean, what I do think we seem to be moving away from is the auteur theory of games that certainly was very dominant 15 years ago.
Yeah.
You know, you see a lot less of that. It's less common for a game to be a single writer. Lots of people are moving into the campaign world where it's intensely collaborative.
Yeah.
You know, and the people who are pursuing their individual vision are the ones, precisely the ones who are tending to write the very small games,
exactly,
because they're easier to do with one or two people.
And it's much easier to be an auteur in that small format.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of interesting looking at it. I mean, I generally gravitate towards 30 to 40 player games for my stuff, and that's that is now on sort of the upper edge of the size that we do here.
Yeah,
things have definitely we have drifted towards the small. I suspect that the kind of mix that we've got now is likely to be where things settle for Intercon, but I don't know.
And that might be just a trend that will change as people's needs change.
Yeah.
So, thinking about it, you were talking about campaigns in Boffer, and if I think back to the 90s, what we had in theater was big weekend events and campaigns. And those were the two primary forms that we had. I wonder... when you look out at 15 years, whether we see less Boffer campaigns.
Possibly. I mean, you know, I suspect that we will continue to have campaigns. I mean, the thing is, one thing that I think is likely to happen is that people are going to start seeing the essentially combat mechanic as just one dimension. I think we're going to keep having campaigns. I think there's going to be more variation of what those campaigns are.
I think you're already beginning to see it, because when you look, you know, in the 90s in Boffer, you were seeing games which were functionally never ending. They're bounded.
Yeah,
many of them are bounded by a certain amount of time.
3-year arcs.
And you know, that trend, they're getting smaller, there are less players in them, and they're getting shorter.
And we've seen the 4-hour Boffer game, which is
which is great,
but it's very interesting that was very successful.
And I think in the past several years there's been a number of one shot Boffer games, you know, full weekends, but still, there's the Cthulhu game that runs. There's a Cthulhu game that runs at Yield Commons. There's another couple of survival games that run at Yield Commons. They're series. There's a series of them. There's one each year, but they're not, and there's maybe the same world, but they're not. It's not a campaign.
And that offers an interesting dynamic to the Boffer game, because there's a much different feel when you've got a limited time space. One of the things that's very difficult for in a Boffer game when you if you're a campaign is that you're very committed to your character's survival. In a game like a survival game like that, if your character dies after 2 hours, you can still sort of say, "Well, I was playing that game pretty well." You know, it's a one-day game, and we're not all expected to survive. I didn't lose that game; it's perfectly fine, and I'm not as committed to this character in the way that I would be in a campaign.
Yeah, well, I mean, and that's you know, picking up the same phenomenon that's been observed in the theater style world all along.
Yes.
You know, there are plenty of us who look at it and say a really good death scene is totally worth it.
If we're starting to see more of those shorter Boffer games, are we starting to see Boffer games that have pre-gen characters the way many theater style games?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. I think you will, if at least in build, if nothing else. But I think probably in character history and things like that. And that also lends another aspect of how the writers are going to integrate their stories, because obviously when you give someone a character history, you can drop game information and story information into those character histories,
right,
which is something we always do in theater. And it's something that a lot of Boffer campaigns can't rely on in their players.
So the,
right,
the games that ran, the both of the Boffer games, mm-hmm, that ran at Intercon last year were GM-created characters.
Mm-hmm.
The ones that I have seen hit the big committee this year are the same.
Yeah. Well, I mean, by and large, the Intercon scenario, it's easier to do with GM-created characters.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, it's sort of, you need very different coordination than we're used to for player-created.
We've had some in the past which were, if you are, you know, this is a, in the world of a existing campaign, if you,
mm-hmm,
have a character from that campaign, don't bring it. Otherwise,
yeah.
You know, otherwise, we'll build you something.
And just Boffer in theater.
The theater too.
Yeah.
Right. Somebody's kicked off their the rerun of their campaign, Northern rerun,
mm-hmm,
with a 4-hour game,
mm-hmm,
at Intercon, and you created your character and started playing it, and some people continued on to the campaign, and some people did not.
Mm-hmm.
So the Shadows pretty cool, was that?
Yeah, the Shadows is very small.
Is some of that partly because when you are running at Intercon, you have very little control over the players you get?
Well, yeah, that's
that
a consideration
that
you have to be careful
about. For a lot of campaign games, you apt for the game.
Not for Boffer
not
games.
Typical for, yeah.
Normally.
Yeah.
So I think right now in Boffer games, my experience of it is that anyone can create a character, and every once in a while there will be an event cap, and so you may not be able to play if too many people want to play.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
It's really more sort of a first-come, first-serve.
Just like Intercom.
Event by event.
And occasionally people are asked not to come back because of rules problems or behavior problems.
And
that's
also true.
That's a different problem.
Which is a different thing. But generally the staff or the writers, if a player comes to them with an idea that's just unworkable, the writers will respond back to them and say, no, this is not possible. You can't be the king of this land. That's ridiculous. And work with the players to create a backstory that does fit with their world or something like that. Having said that, you know, a lot of times the writers will accept very extreme circumstances and will allow players to play, you know, the characters that they're interested in playing. This game is not about Amnesia, but if you really want to play Amnesia character, all right, we'll try to fit that into your, and you'll have that game. Actual case.
So I've never played a campaign theater game.
Mm.
I don't know what they tend to cost to play in. The cost is so high in Boffer games to the GMs that it behooves them to not turn away more players than they have to.
Yes.
At $85 a head, just to cover costs.
Just
but
to cover, yeah,
you know,
site costs and insurance and things like that, yeah.
I mean, this sort of stable system of Boffer is that you're running these weekend-long events, with a few one-days thrown in. Theater campaigns that I have seen tend to be a series of one-day events with an occasional weekend thrown in.
Right.
And
right.
The costs, of course, go way down because you don't have to house everyone and, you know,
right,
figure out food and all that sort of
right
thing as much for a one-day event.
Yeah.
Mm.
Insurance, if it exists, is cheaper, too.
Yes, because, there's, you know, the...
It's less physical.
It's not as... It's a different insurance form, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So... You know, one of the things that I think is going to have to come up at some point, so I might as well bring it up now.
Yep.
You know, clearly, you know, we live in a technologically different age than we did 15 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
How much do you guys think that has fundamentally impacted LARP? Where and where do you see that going?
So far, I don't think it has changed things very much. You know, we have seen, you know, bits around the edges where modern tech comes in. I mean, you know, your Blackout game, you know, was fundamentally dependent upon the availability of Arduino building blocks. I suspect it's going to start happening more, and the thing that 15 years is long enough that I suspect that we are going to start seeing some real bleed over between MMO and LARP. You know, as we start getting, you know, while Google Glass per se is probably a fad, the number of people, Yeah, I mean, the number of people who... Many of the people who got really enthusiastic about Google Glass did so precisely because of the augmented reality capabilities and mainly because of the game capabilities.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, they, a lot of people were very into that.
No longer information in envelopes. You can actually see the information if you have the skill.
Right. And, you know, my suspicion is that we're going to see some very interesting experiments starting to happen where... people start using some of this heads-up tech to essentially bleed between a computer game and a real-world game. I think we've seen only the beginning scratches of that. Over 15 years, I'd bet we're going to see a lot more.
Yeah.
Well, actually, one of the places I've seen the rise of modern technology have an impact, oddly enough, is with props and costumes.
True.
Because now, you know, now anybody can go on Amazon and order a piece of costume or a piece of prop that's particular, that's exactly what they want for their character.
And possibly even more significantly, you can go onto Shapeways and create this weird little prop.
Right. Or you can go on Instructables and find instructions on exactly how to build, you know, the brass goggles for your steampunk character or something like that. And the availability of information as well as the internet retailing, I think, has stepped up on the game for costumes and props.
Yeah, you're going to see a lot more of that, I think, particularly in boffer campaigns and things like that with 3D printing, where you can make not just a prop, but a prop specific to this world, you know, with the specific heraldry, with the specific designations, and you're going to have the specifications, and you can just, you will be able to tell your 3D printer, I really need this piece.
Right. Well, and the thing is, you can already do a lot of that.
I've seen some of it,
I almost reran Girl Genius a couple of years ago, and one of the interesting things there was I was able to go on to Shapeways, which is essentially a clearinghouse, and it's an online cloud-based store for doing 3D printing that has a number of people, essentially has bulletin boards for matching artists to people who need stuff.
It's also a service where they have the printers and they will print stuff.
Yeah, right, and they have many different materials.
They have printers that you could never afford.
One of the things that I almost did, if that game had come to pass, there's a core prop that in the original run of Girl Genius just had to be an item card because it was impossible, that I sort of realized, no, we could, that prop could actually be made with a 3D printer.
Yeah.
And it was a really neat realization that you can just start to do these completely insane things.
Yeah.
Rising maker culture in general that's affecting all of this with CNCs and laser cutters.
One of the things that's true in boffer camp or local boffer campaign community is to get experience, you can donate props. So it encourages makers to actually make great, cool props for these games. And, in one game I'm in right now, there is a 3D printer enthusiast who has his own 3D printer. So has been making very interesting, intricate props out of using the 3D printer, very specific game props for it. And it was a very interesting thing to see him come out and, you know, working on these things.
Yeah, and that's not, I mean, that's getting practically, that's consumer level stuff at this point. I mean, they're starting to come out with 3D printers, good ones that only cost $400. So we're going to see nothing but more of that.
And that's definitely going to affect the way that these games are run and some of the prop that are available because, you know, even for a fantasy element where if you belong to a specific group or something like that, you can standardize your heraldry, you can standardize your items, you can standardize consumable props, things like, you know, this is a specific potion or so you have the same bottle for each one of these. And the thing that's interesting is, depending on your player base, depending on the availability of this technology, the players will be able to do that themselves without GM or interaction or interference. One of the things that's true in this one game, which is right now interesting, Occam's Razor, is they have a great back end behind this where players can generate and make things. And it spits out item cards right now. And it's basically they grab tags, they've got a scanner code for the different elements they use. Once they've got the inventory, they can use their online, essentially, account to then put these together and make things. and that spits out a tag. And this is all player driven. The GMs don't interact with that at all. At some point, I see that happening with physical items.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I mean, in general, there's both the physical side and there's the information technology, the rise of that as a consumer thing. I mean, you know, I certainly have ambitions for, you know, Quirky to be a platform for to make it easier for people to write stuff and organize the information about games. But yeah, I mean, in general, I expect it's going to be mostly in lots and lots of little things. I mean, you know, I don't think there's going to be any one dramatic leap there. I think it's mostly just that the fact that it's getting easier for normal people to do stuff like that, to create things, to organize information.
Yeah,
I think that's just going to become ubiquitous, and it's going to have a lot of subtle changes.
Yeah, I mean, I think when we think back in terms of the impact that it has had so far, you don't see it so much. I think if you were to walk into a LARP, you know, right now, I don't think that you see that you would see that much difference. You might see, as you say, nicer costuming because people have more access to it. You might see a lot easier to, you know, with the rise of sort of digital photography and availability of that. You might see people being able to reference things more easily, like look up authentic costuming without going to the library, you know, things like that. But I think the place where you really see the difference, and I think it actually really does push on us, is the commoditization of logistics.
Right.
So,
yep.
You know, if you're going to say, like, I'm going to run a game and it's going to be really a pain, I'm going to have to go to places and ask people that will play in this game, then they will mail me something and I'll go back and forth. I mean,
the good old days.
Years ago, not everyone had email.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And when we were running Intercon back then, it was a paper form that you filled out and we had to process. And that makes the process of running something like Intercon very difficult. And so you don't do it as often. But when it becomes commoditized, you're like, oh, I have this automatic system that will handle most of this stuff for me without me having to put a lot of work in. And you get the rise of you know, things like Festival and other mini game weekends where they're like, well, we wouldn't want to, you know, who wants to sit around and, you know, like, get all this mail and things, but if we have the system to do that, we're willing to do the rest of the work. And so that is sort of like places where I begin to see that sort of like, it's, you know, what you're talking about is a little bit like, okay, how does technology push on like the high end? How does it improve the quality? But I think there's also this sort of thing of saying, where does it bring up the low end to make it easier and easier and easier to be able to like reduce barriers to get in? You know, like you're talking about making it easier to write and, you know.
Yeah.
Well, even this past year, we stopped printing and stuffing con packets. So we're, again, using technology, the availability of digital information to bring up the logistics and reduce the loads so that we can focus on the things that are really important.
Yeah, I mean, we've got the rise of the commoditization of money, essentially. You know, the rise of things like Square and PayPal that make it much easier to deal with the money side of running a game.
That's
you know,
true.
Not tossing checks around is a big change.
When did you start taking Bitcoin?
Right now.
Yeah.
I'll believe that one when I see it, but
we'll let you into Intercon for one Bitcoin. It's only one Bitcoin. Just one.
$800 now. It's a question of, you know, what was it an hour ago as opposed to what is it today?
We've seen to some extent the fact that you can almost count on all of your players having smartphones.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. At
and
this
we're
point,
not quite there, but it, you know, in another
but,
5 years,
but many people
you
do.
Can count on. I think I suspect 5 years from now, it'll be a point where everyone either has a smartphone or everyone has a bucket of smartphones that they've used to have that are probably still work that you could fire up and hand to somebody for the purpose of a game.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, we are certainly. I'm certainly starting to see bids for games that assume that everyone has a smartphone, and you know the game uses smartphones for mechanics. I mean, that's
the game I just mentioned is scanning codes using a smartphone.
Right.
You assume that access is there.
Yeah,
assume that at least a certain percentage of the players use that.
And I've seen games that have started to say we're only printing character sheets for people who ask for them.
Right.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I mean, in general, one of the key changes is the fact that, so much technology is becoming ubiquitous now. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's going to keep on playing out, and it's hard to say in exactly what ways. I mean, you know, 15 years, the problem with trying to speculate about 15 years from now is that it's far enough out that the tech will certainly have done things that we didn't imagine. You know, you consider the fact that, you know, the new trendy device is smartwatches, which, you know, became trendy 6 months ago and have only been around for about 3 years. Mm-hmm. And now they are the gadget that everybody is trying to get in the tech community, and they're going to be widespread in another 2 or 3 years. Mm-hmm. You know, what effect is that going to have? I don't know. But I mean, it's going to, you know, you take things like a smartwatch and you speculate about it. This is a contingency envelope.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, one of the hardest problems in a theater style game is a mechanic that when you run into person X, open this envelope, which just tells the player that of course I'm supposed to be looking for person X. It's a big problem.
Yeah.
When you've got stuff like this that's ubiquitous, you can build tech to do all of that.
Yeah, and you don't know.
Right. I mean, the player may not even know that their watch is going to buzz when they come near this person, and it's going to give them a message that says you need to talk to this person and open envelope foo.
Yeah.
You know, we're gonna start seeing things like that as tech becomes more ubiquitous. People are going to come up with clever ways to use it.
I mean, I definitely agree, but at the same time, I think that the medium does resist it a little bit.
It does.
In the sense that, you know, we are trying to create typically a place where you are not surrounded by the same things you're surrounded by otherwise. So if I'm walking through the game, I have to look at my watch every time it buzzes, and it buzzes every time, you know, mm-hmm. someone in the broader world wants my attention.
It's going to be,
you know, like you have that, you know, just as an example, you have that tension mm-hmm. between, like, I really want to be ignoring my watch right now because mm-hmm. that's something that is my everyday thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's a
challenge of verisimilitude. On the other hand, it's a challenge we have now. And so, you know, I'm sure that we're going to see a lot of experimentation of what the implications of ubiquitous tech are. And some of those experiments will work and some of them will fail miserably. And, you know, it'll be interesting to see where we wind up. But I'm fairly sure that it's going to have a lot of impact on mechanics. You know, I think that our assumptions about item cards and envelopes and stuff like that are probably going to change a lot over the next 15 years. I would bet we're going to find better ways to do a lot of that stuff.
Local information dissemination. There will be better ways of doing
that. I like to see a GM collecting up a bunch of old PDAs, tricorder type things, and saying, here, handing them to the players instead of, here's your name badge, here's your index card, here's your character.
Well, what's
here's your tricorder device. You can leave your smartwatch at home if you don't want it buzzing, because I'm going to provide the device.
Yeah, well, I mean, once they're cheap enough, I'm all over that. I mean, Tabula Rasa has had PDAs written into the game as a major game element since 1995. Now, your PDA was represented by a sheaf of paper,
mm-hmm.
but it was conceptually a PDA. I look forward to the idea of being able to just hand somebody, you know, a device and say, yes, this holds lots of your information on it.
In Occam's Razor, they actually do have 4 laptop stations, and these are the in-game game laptop stations programmed for that game with the things that your characters are supposed to know. So you don't actually bring your laptop to that game. You use the in-game version and you interact with it that way.
Yeah.
So they have programmed this to create an interface, and it's not yours, so you don't have to worry about getting your email on these.
Mm-hmm.
You get game email specifically on there, and your accounts are just the in-game accounts.
Yeah, now that's going to create its own chunk of work. I mean, I expect that we are opening ourselves up to spending a lot of time building
mm-hmm.
tech. I mean, this is one of the things I'm looking at for Tabula Rasa 3, yeah. is that the computer system in TR3, the computer systems are going to be real computer systems because they might as well be.
Mm-hmm.
And
science fiction.
And you know, there's going to be, suffice it to say, TR3 is going to have some CGI requirements that I'm going to have to spend some time finding people to program for me.
You mentioned, you know, the idea of, like, computer games sort of melding in things like that,
mm-hmm.
but I think that it's interesting because that would really change things, because what we expect out of a computer game mm-hmm. is not, well, maybe it will be in the future, but right now it is not something that it would vastly complicate the process of building a game.
It would make
it a lot more work, and especially if you wanted to be able to compete
mm-hmm.
with, you know, professionally produced computer games, in the sense that you want to be able to have that same feeling of expectation of quality, even if you're not matching your at least.
I suspect that we're not going to see our style of amateur LARPs competing with the current computer games. But what we are going to see is LARPs pulling in technology that is 5 to 8 years old. Because
right.
that which is cutting edge today is consumer grade tomorrow.
Right.
This brings up the standardization question again. And I think in terms of the back end in some LARPs, you're going to see a popularity that people are going to try to standardize the back end.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to standardize things like, you know, item control, inventory control, character, the submissions and things like this.
Mm-hmm.
There are already some people trying to create standards for these things.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to see, with that work being lifted for people, it'll be easier to run a campaign, a game, things like this. And you're going to see things like the sort of interactive element, someone's going to end up standardizing how to do that. So it's going to become easier to create this sort of virtual reality within a space, because there's going to be a standard there, and you can just sort of go ahead and either, you know, buy access to the standard or something like that, and just drop your information within a space. You know, it's going to ask what your space is like, which players, and it's going to be a back end that you can use.
But that said, I mean, it's going to start out with some people spending an awful
yes.
lot of effort doing things as one-offs.
Yeah.
And as they do that and they get it right, and
mm-hmm.
people say that's cool and try to do the same thing, that's what's going to lead to standardization.
Yeah.
Is sort of once you get a consensus of this is really cool and useful, that's when people start to say, okay, how can we do this in a reusable fashion?
Yes, without having five programmers on our writing team.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I think that, you know, one of the things that you talked about a couple of times, security, virtual spaces, and you know, like simulating spaces, but I also do see, and it's something I have seen a little more trending, is that, you know, we think of them as co-located spaces, but seeing games that are that are not co-located.
We'll see some of that.
You know, distance play games,
yeah. mm-hmm.
either with two physical spaces or a virtual presence.
Yeah,
so, you
yeah,
know,
yeah.
Things like that. I do see that more and more
yeah.
often.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in different, especially in longer form games where people can, you know, send email back and forth and they don't care where the person emailing is. But also even just, I mean, you know, for example, having a control room with a closed circuit television camera too.
Mm-hmm.
To another room so that you can communicate, you know, across like that. And obviously you don't necessarily need to be CCTV, but it can be,
mm-hmm.
you know, a web, so you can have them as far apart as you want.
Or Skype.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Simple things like that. I mean,
yep.
they're simple now, but 15 years ago they were not simple
yeah.
to do, right?
You've got an NPC who is, you know, someone's boss, and they can just Skype in.
Right.
You can have an additional, you know, NPC player, a writer,
yeah.
you know,
I,
just
I,
doing
I,
that.
I've been seeing that happening with... I haven't been involved in the buffer campaigns, but in the theater-style campaigns that I've been involved in, I'm
mm-hmm.
seeing a lot of activity between events happening in forums, Google Hangouts,
oh, yeah.
people getting together in character, just being in character, and maybe following up on plots that they dropped between events.
Forums
but,
are big, yeah.
Yeah, the forums are really big now in a way that they weren't 15 years ago.
Yeah. yeah.
And I see more of that virtual community character space. I don't know about plot space, but definitely character space.
Plot too, yeah.
Now that he mentions that, it actually reminds me out there in Canada with that big large
mm-hmm.
event.
Mm-hmm.
They actually, what they're doing is throughout the year, within the people don't play it,
mm-hmm.
but they have an email system
mm-hmm.
where they actually allow the players to continue playing
mm-hmm.
with using email. But nowadays they're doing emails instead of sending letters.
Mm-hmm.
And then when they receive the letters, like they say, one guy gave me an example. He was a pirate. You know, he's the captain of the pirate group. He says, I want to conquer this village and steal a ship and drive out with it. Get out with it. And he sent the letter out, and he has to wait for the answer. And it can be, yes, you have success, or you don't have success. And from
mm-hmm.
there, you have to continue figuring out what to do. And that's crazy. Some people are telling me they don't even go to the events anymore. They're just playing it.
Yeah.
sending the letters, mm-hmm. emails, getting it back, getting the correspondence.
In which case, it becomes more of an MMO or something like that.
Yeah,
yeah.
I mean,
but it's all right.
I think, by and large, what people are looking for is a role-playing experience,
yeah.
and they're going for, and different people are into different aspects of the
mm-hmm.
role-playing experience. And so, you know, you're going to see a lot of blurring of the lines, inevitably.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think it really is, it's a little hard to know where the MMO LARP crossover is going to be. I'm just fairly sure that it's going to happen because it's so easy for it to happen. I think it's mostly just a matter at this point of people experimenting until they come up with some formulas that work.
Well, you can easily imagine, you know, a scenario wherein you're going to put together a traditional role-playing game, whatever, you know, style. People bring in characters that they then create in an MMO and they go out and do adventures together online and
yep.
come back and bring that information, whatever it is, back into
mm-hmm.
into the, you know, the traditional place.
Does anyone try to run a standard theater style LARP using Second Life as the co-located space?
I know at least a few experiments with it, but
yeah, I mean, Second Life is, the tech is still a tad on the primitive side,
mm-hmm.
But yeah, no, I'm not surprised that people have tried to do that.
Yeah, I mean that kind of thing where you can sort of say, okay, you know, we're going to run and, you know, adventure, you know, things that might have, you know, in Boffer be a module or in theater be a little adventure with a, you know, almost a tabletop style adventure where you sit down with the GM and be like, okay, we're going to go to the, you know, whatever, and
mm-hmm.
kind of run, talks you through it. That could be mediated by.
Yeah. What I find most interesting, though, is the notion of the virtual space starting to intrude on real space. You know, this is why Google Glass and things like that, the wearable and immersive technologies, have a lot of interesting potential to create some strange new game styles.
Yes. has anyone written character sheets for Ingress?
Not that I know of, but I mean, you know, Ingress was a popular enough. I mean, I think it's a fad, but it definitely showed the potential for the form there. And I think to some degree that was the point of the exercise. I mean,
yeah.
you know, Ingress was kind of a mass social experiment to see what you could do.
We'll just start it up again.
Did
heavily
it?
In the last
yeah.
2 weeks because the iOS version just came out.
Yeah.
It was a lot more users suddenly.
So yep. iOS version of Ingress, really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. I never expected to actually see that happen.
It's taken off, yeah. Yeah. I think one of the other things that we may end up seeing is that in a social sense, LARP is coming out of the closet in a big way. And that's going to have a lot of effects in the next 10 to 15 years.
Mm-hmm.
In a couple of weeks, there is a big ABC show, which is a LARP
mm-hmm.
show, a LARP reality game
really?
Show.
Yeah.
The Quest.
Okay.
And there is a gamer.
I have low hopes for that.
What?
I have low hopes for it.
We have a member of Intercon who is in that.
Really?
You know, yeah, and she's a local Boffer gamer, and it's going to be the reaction to that could be really supportive or not, but I think it's definitely a sign that it's becoming a popular thing. It's entered mainstream culture a lot more already, and let's face it, it's a great thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's a great form of entertainment in a culture that demands entertainment, and there's going to be at some point we've already sort of faced with Intercon maxing out.
Yes,
that may become even more of a problem as the popularity of LARPs grow. Is that you know, we're on the start of a what could potentially be a huge popular culture thing.
Well, let me ask, you know, I don't know if we have any gaming historians in the room, but like,
mm-hmm.
you know, big gaming conventions, I'm thinking, you know, Gen Con or
mm-hmm.
this kind of thing, you know, where were they at? How quickly did they grow? And what was their arc of growth?
Oh, well, look at Penny Arcade. That's one that we've seen in the past 15 years.
That's a weird example because that was run by an incredibly popular
the reason I asked about the historical ones is because it's more like the emergent property. Like, I think the arcade was like, we're going to take something which is incredibly popular already, which is video games, and build something, you know. But so I'm more thinking like, you know, where does that hockey stick, if it's going to happen, how are we going to predict it? And maybe looking
at it's hard to predict.
And,
yeah.
Or something like that.
I'm not sure there is a good way to predict it. I mean, you know, when I think about, you know, on the one end, you've got SDCC, which, you know, certainly, you know, I thought of as a big convention back in the day, but it wasn't a huge convention. Now it's insane. I mean, Comic-Con gets north of 100,000 people. You know, it is beyond crazy.
I feel like that's been the last 8 years or something.
Yes. But on the other hand, you've got, say, Penzic, which back in the day we were looking at exponential growth, and we were seeing absolutely steady exponential growth for about 10 years, and we were starting to go, what do we do about this? And then it just leveled off abruptly. And there were specific in-club reasons why it leveled off. And, I mean, I think the moral of the story there is, you know, you can hit insane growth if you hit a cultural moment. You know, if for some reason this art form becomes cool, and moreover, if it becomes a moneymaker, or you can make a mistake and just slow down.
Well, I also see it somewhat as a generational thing. For most of these origins, Gen Con, when they started with their first generation of attendees, it was smaller, it was quieter, and then as that generation started to have kids and it became more normalized, and then you could start selling nostalgia about it and things like that. Now we've seen a huge rise with, you know, reselling things that were popular in the 80s, and they've become popular again, comic books, sci-fi and fantasy to a certain extent, as that first generation or so, or second generation has started to bring their children into it, and it's become another mainstream. It's becoming more mainstream that way.
You know, I mean, the key thing is it's become mass culture in a way that it's never really been before. I mean, you know, the comic books, while they've had waves of being at the center of mass culture, they've never been like they are now. I mean, they have taken over the media to a degree that, as a longtime comic book fan, on the one hand, it warms my heart, and on the other hand, it's terrifying.
Yeah.
You know, it is very strange, the fact that, you know, half the movies and TV shows coming out at this point are based on stories I've been reading for 25 years. So, I mean, it's a little hard to predict how that works, though. You know.
Yeah, where do you go, how do you go from marginalized to mainstream? Is going to be hard to predict. One of the things, though, I think LARP has a potential for is that it's a safe form of imaginative play.
True.
And this is something, as the world goes on, is going to be much more needed in society. But also, we're talking about the future of LARP. In forms of today's parenting culture, straight up, LARP is a very safe thing to expose kids to a certain degree. One of the hugest... growing summer camps right now in the area is a Boffer summer camp.
Yep.
And it's called Guard Up runs it, and it's a big money maker, if nothing else.
And has been getting an increasing amount of very favorable mainstream press.
Exactly. And it's one of those things which is going to become more prevalent in society as things go on. You're going to see more camps like that, and even camps which are just straight up Girl Scout, Boy Scout camps are going to take on LARP elements. They're going to have LARP modules. I wouldn't be surprised if there's a LARP Boy Scout badge sometime in the future, which would be kind of ridiculous. But it's going to become something that is a little more mainstream because it is a useful way of interacting.
You know, that actually raises some interesting questions of LARP culture, and specifically the LARP subcultures. Because we're gonna have an interesting time dealing with the impact of that. You know, as things go mainstream, there is always a lot of pressure to make things safer, to make them more more alike in a lot of ways. And so I suspect that one of the things we're going to see, if things do move in that direction, I think you're probably right, I think we're going to see some pushback from people who want edgier stuff in their games. And
yeah.
And there's going to be a lot of back and forth of how do you accommodate both ends of that.
Mm-hmm.
As video games became mainstream, they started self-rating and self-policing. Are we going to be doing that with LARPs?
Yeah, probably.
Probably. Well, I suspect that, I mean, it'll be interesting to see whether we do it before we're forced to do it. I mean, video games did not do that voluntarily. Video games did that because it was very clear that Congress was going to do something unless they started self-rating. And which is, I mean, it's the same thing that happened to comic books.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, comic books, you know, created the Comics Code Authority because there were Senate hearings.
Yeah.
And that continued for 30 years until everyone basically said, yeah, we don't need this anymore. Go away. So if it gets really mainstream, then yeah, it will happen for some reason or another.
There are already certain ratings within the culture. There are already certain,
right.
even here at Intercon, you know, we are being to put warnings, trigger warnings, specific warnings on different games, and there is some self-policing going on in there.
Right, and that's been a topic of ongoing conversation over the life of this convention.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, back when we started, back at the time of Intercon 13, there was a significant population within the ConCom that firmly believed that every game should be kid-friendly and we should never, ever have age limits on games.
Wow.
And that continued, and I don't even know when that changed and we started allowing age limits in. It was sometime in the past 15 years.
5 years in, I would say.
Okay.
I was going to say about Intercom C.
Okay.
That makes sense.
But it was a huge argument. We actually lost some members of the ConCom because
wow.
they were dead set that
mm-hmm.
you know, age restrictions were evil and we should never, ever have them. And so, you know, the notion of sort of self-rating games like that has happened over the past 15 years.
Yeah. And I think you'll see more of that and maybe some more granularity
mm-hmm.
in what how games are rated or what to expect from games. And I know this is also something that goes into the buffer games where different safety regulations are always discussed. Is it latex approved weapons? Which weapons are approved? How do these no touch versus what kind of touches are allowed within games?
Yep.
And that's something that has legal ramifications and is going to have to be coded.
Yep. And, you know, I mean, there's going to be lots of experimentation. I mean,
mm-hmm.
you know, the funny thing is the amount of stuff that's going to happen in the next 15 years that we can't even see coming.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what are the issues that are going to arise and become problems that we don't even see right now because they're just part of the culture?
Recording games.
Right, sure.
That's going to be a big one.
With the rise in ubiquitous tech
mm-hmm.
and with the potential for mainstream growth, at what point does somebody try to open up Dream Park?
Oh, it's going to happen. Well, I mean, the thing is, Dream Park per se requires a lot of advanced tech. That's more than 15 years off. But the early stages of it, sure, that's certainly within the
but
next 15 years, I'll bet.
The 2, it's the 5 weeks.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, people are already starting.
What that is.
Yeah, people are already starting to play with that in limited ways. I mean, there's money to be made there,
yeah.
And where there's money to be made, people will start doing it.
And that's the other thing too is that this hobby is going to become monetized at some point. There are right now some people definitely looking to make profits in LARP. I think that's going to become more. I can't imagine it, but at some point I see, you know, some sort of mall store that is LARPs R Us or something like that. But it's going to happen. You know, I would never have guessed that a store like Hot Topic in the 80s would ever exist.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a standard store right now.
Eric was telling us yesterday that there are, you know, LARP supply stores, physical storefronts, LARP supply
yeah.
stores. And I think that is a matter of population more than anything else.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
It's you have enough, just in terms of the supply stores.
Yeah.
You know, in terms of, and that's the same model that we see with tabletop gaming, which has been monetized, but not through its primary activity,
mm-hmm.
right? Like, people don't generally pay to turn up to their weekly game to play.
But the thing about LARP, LARP has scale in a way that tabletop doesn't. You know, it is more straightforward to build a LARP game that people can pay a lot of money and that a lot of people can pay a lot of money and do for a limited amount of time. And that means that the potential for money making is a lot higher than it ever was for tabletop. And frankly, LARP... The costs are higher too, but that helps justify the amount you're charging. But it's also... So LARP... You can reduce LARP to more of a spectator sport. And I would bet that we're going to see a lot of that. You know, I would bet one of the things about tabletop in particular is that playing tabletop without being individually imaginative as a player is very hard. You don't get anything satisfying out of it. But it is not hard for people to build an immersive LARP thing where the players are more or less being run through something that is conceptually a dungeon crawl. And that is likely to be easier to monetize to the mass market.
I Sleep No More.
Exactly. That's another possibility.
I never thought of Sleep No More as a LARP, but it's an amusing point.
And at MIT, frequently they have students who just watch the games being played out.
Right. And that's the kind of thing that's easy to monetize. You know, and I would bet that we're going to see that. And what will evolve, I mean, you know, we'll almost certainly wind up with a certain amount of tension between the people who are doing these stupid mass market stuff that's really annoying to those of us who are into the art of it.
Well, we are going to see a little bit with the Box Murder Mysteries, right? Like,
right, well, and those have always been around.
Right,
yeah.
They've always been around, but we don't ever play them.
Right, yeah, true,
like,
true.
Whatever, it's like, you know what I'm going to do? Is I'm going to bring one of these box games to
Intercon. To Intercon, yeah, because it's...
They bring them to
it.
Festival.
What?
They brought them to Festival.
Kind of as a joke.
No? It's because it's super low threshold, low barrier.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's easy to
right.
for some amount, some level of entertainment.
Yeah,
and that is what I expect to be the stuff we most see show up on the mass market is stuff that is very low barrier to entry.
Right.
You know, and that is not going to be the kind of games we have here by and large. But on that said, we would probably be well advised to treat those as a gateway drug.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to be very clear of if you like that and you want a better and more interesting and more involving experience, we have lots of things for you to play with.
Neil has the Game Bank, which is specifically an attempt to make games available for anybody to take and to run at no cost.
Mm-hmm.
And I think if this does hit mainstream, we will see a rise of boxed products that anybody can pick up and run for a fee.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Likely.
Yeah.
Likely.
So, I mean, very much like those murder mysteries.
Dance
right.
in the Dawn is now available to buy online.
What is it?
Dance in the Dawn.
Okay, that's
how it is. Emily Jerboss publishes her stuff. Not all of it's LARP.
They recently ran, Dance in the Dawn ran in New York for a paying audience.
That's right.
Yeah. At a theater.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, there are ways to make small amounts of money even now,
mm-hmm.
but the large amounts of money to be able to sustain an industry is where you start getting into some really, really challenging
mm-hmm.
questions. You know?
Well, yeah, I mean, I think the challenges are going to be mostly from an artistic point of view. I mean, you know, I don't think there's anything terribly hard about that. It just needs to grow. And the question is, are we at the cultural moment yet where mainstream society is ready for that? And I don't think we're going to know until somebody tries. Well, I mean, I'm honestly not sure.
No.
We are deeply enough immersed in geek culture these days. I mean, in a world where Big Bang Theory is the number one show on television, geekery is a lot more mainstream than people tend to think.
Sure.
And that has grown a lot in the past 10 years. There are probably a lot of things that are possible that we assume aren't possible because they weren't possible 10 years ago.
We also might miss it. We might. Geeks might go out of fashion next, you know, 5 years from now.
Yeah.
And, you know, that, you know, where does that put us? Mm-hmm. Really, just because,
yeah.
you know, looking in the rearview mirror doesn't mean, you know, there are a lot of things which
mm-hmm.
have gone out of fashion.
Yeah.
We'll rebrand as interactive sports and we'll be fine.
Yeah.
Aren't all sports?
MPAA, RIAA, Writers Guild Associations, do we see a professional organization of game writers or representing game players or other game interests?
My guess is not until that mass market happens. You know, things like the RIAA typically have grown up as essentially unions. I mean, they are there because as a way for the creative folks to keep themselves from being exploited by the money people. That's not a problem for us now because there's no money people.
Right.
Yeah. But eventually, if there is money people, yes, I think that will be the case. Yeah.
Though certainly there will be folks. I am sure that organizations like that will be created. Whether they are successful or not depends on whether they can cross the divide between the union mentality and the creative mentality, which is always an interesting tension.
Mm.
You know, some activities, you know, there's nothing terribly obvious about which activities actually develop professional organizations like that actually have teeth, as opposed to
SAG seems to be pretty good.
You're right.
Mm-hmm.
But that's all about rate.
Yes.
For, you know, whereas, you know,
The MPAA is a different beast entirely. That's really a trade organization.
Right.
And again, there's no need for that to exist now, but if there starts being money around, you bet it's going to happen.
Yeah.
What about artistic direction?
That's the hardest to predict. I mean, I like to assume that people will continue to do crazy experiments. And some of those experiments will work.
Yeah.
I'm going to limit to 15 years. It's going to be a bunch of high fantasy buffer LARPs running.
You know, 20 years ago, we would have said that there was no end in sight for vampire and werewolf games.
Yeah, right. It's
running.
True.
There's still a lot of juggernauts.
Yeah.
They've become a bit lowest common denominator. They're the Magic the Gathering of the LARP world.
You're not faking that.
Well, probably not. Neither do the Magic players. Yes, it is hard to say where that's going to go. My suspicion is that, you know, fantasy buffer stuff is not going to go away. I suspect that we will see more variety in the campaign buffer world. I mean, we've been seeing that for the past 10 years.
Yeah,
there's already a lot of variety.
Yes.
I think that as you get more people, you need more competition, right? You need to differentiate yourself in some way.
Yeah.
Right.
For me, there's a parallel in the tabletop role playing game. In the past 5-10 years, there's been an explosion in alternate forms, alternate rule sets, indie styles, new universes of tabletop role playing games as well.
I think that we have a parallelism there, and also in, you know, just in general, in our media consumption has become less packaged, in large packages. You see apps, you can buy individual songs and individual episodes of, you know, of things, and people, I think, are just consuming things in a slightly different way, you know, like...
You're suggesting selling individual characters out of a game?
is that you don't necessarily need like you want to end up with like the mini game is our example of that.
Yeah.
You know, it used to be that in order to make it worth me, you know, getting up in the morning to go to a LARP, it's gotta have to be at least, you know, 70 characters in a weekend long, you know. Why would I even bother for anything less than that? And why would I 10-15 years ago, if someone said, I'll sell you this piece of software for $1, I'd be like, this is clearly not worth anything.
There's this,
you know,
well,
but now...
Part of it now, though, is that we sell mixtapes instead of individual albums. You can come play multiple small games at once.
Well, right. one of the things that's interesting, in a case like this, there is a campaign game right now that had a Kickstarter, and what one of the things they offered is, within this campaign world, you and 10 friends can have an event.
Someone bought it.
They did buy it. And this was like a little portion. This is almost like the little piece of this game world. And it was monetization in a big way. And it was very successful for this game. It's the Kickstarter was definitely helped them start. It gets
fiscal. Fully funded, like,
fully funded and like twice over.
It almost sounds like a patronage system. Like,
it is.
Well, Kickstarter is all about the patronage system.
We don't see what kind of effect it has on the campaign.
It's going to be, that's going to be very interesting.
I'm dubious about how it's going
to play. I'm interested to see how that works itself out, because you've got this small group that has sort of an advantage, because they pay for
it. Money, it's always going to be the case. You're going to have to sell
much per person for it.
15 years ago, if it existed, instead of doing Interactivities, Inc., Mike Young might have done Patreon.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Which is another one of these patronage models where
yeah.
people voluntarily say, I will commit X dollars for every piece of product you produce.
Mm-hmm. And it's an easy thing to lay out. When you think about the cost of a game, putting down $50 to get an advantage in a campaign that you're going to be playing for 3 or 4 years, that cost is minimal.
Mm-hmm.
And that's definitely one of those things.
The mini mod, the one day for those 10 people was $1,500, which split across 10 people. It's still a bit.
It's sizable,
but it also got the person who bought it a bunch of other stuff as well.
Yes,
50% more than a normal campaign,
right.
A normal event.
And that's a full event for a small group of people.
Yes.
And again, it's sort of the sort of chunking of a larger game system where you can just buy a personal thing. I do think that maybe some campaigns or some games will offer small mini games, the 6-person game, the 2-person game, within, as a between game action or between game event, that some people could buy into it or participate in these games and have basically private modules that are character driven, character based, that fit within the world. And that's going to be an interesting kind of effect.
Having seen things like that happen at Realms over years, there will be a backlash against it.
Oh, yeah,
Does it lead to something we've seen in, especially the apps economy, of the free-to-play model?
That's an interesting question, yeah.
Well, and to some extent, we have that model. I mean, it's not quite free-to-play, but basically,
the weekend
like,
is free, but every time you want to interact with an NPC,
Excuse me, give me
$10.
Right now, we don't count, the money is
$20
to deal. Costs, basically, right? with a little bit of, I'm going to buy props, and, there's some amount of choice, but, we're not seeing a model which is going to sustain a business. It is just sustaining of a hobby, right?
Yeah.
And you could sort of say, we're going to keep it really cheap so that, the barrier to entry is low. But then you buy these premium services. And if you want to go on a premium module, then you better let me know ahead of time. And I'm going to give you 5 tickets. And you can say, okay, one of your tickets, you can go on this premium module.
That's what
let me say this.
The Isles was the baseline, let you hang out in the tavern all weekend. And maybe do a one full town thing, but maybe not. And for $20 more, you could actually go out and watch.
Well,
and many people didn't pay the extra because they just wanted to hang out in character all weekend. That was their name experience.
Right.
It's free to NPC, but you have to pay to be a PC.
That's what I'm saying.
You have to do it in order to convince people. So what I've been noticing around here since I've been visiting these LARP events is that people don't want to NPC. They only want to NPC if it's necessary. That's why this... the idea of rotating PC players to NPC, if you want to stay. I mean, I've never ever heard of that until I experienced it here.
Interesting.
I mean, because nobody wants to be NPCs, but then again, the NPCs are not fun characters. So they're there's no motivation. I talked about a lot of people, but they have to make it for free so that people would actually go to the event. I mean, that's what I've been seeing. It's the only motivator for people to still go to the event. Well, at least I don't have to pay, but I have to be an NPC.
LARPs are people. LARPs are made of people.
That's where I see some of the overlap between Boffer and theater happening, is that we're gonna start to redefine NPC for some of these campaign systems. NPC just means GM-generated character.
Yeah.
It's still going to have full plotage, it's still going to have full interaction, but it's going to be GM-directed and GM-controlled because that's what NPCs are for.
Yes, well, I mean, it's really funny. I mean, I look at the boffer stuff, and it's sort of, yeah, if I get involved in boffer stuff, I'll almost certainly do so as an NPC because, you know, as a theater person, that sounds much more like what I think of as the game experience.
A lot depends on how you NPC. There's not a character, it's you, here's your stats.
Right, yeah.
Okay. Also, it depends on the game. Yeah. Some games, NPCs don't even roleplay at all.
We're pretty much at the end. We actually used this entire plot. Yeah.
Yeah.
Huh?
Do you have any closing thoughts? One thing that in your mind absolutely will be there in 15 years, no doubt whatsoever.
People will still be LARPing. I think in 15 years, I think that's definite. Whether or not it takes off and is huge or remains sort of this small hobby, it's still going to happen.
Right. Well, and I mean, my question is, will we actually recognize what they mean by LARPing at that point?
Mm.
I don't know. We'll see.